Good evening and welcome to IPA 50 webinar series. As you all know, we are having this webinar series to commemorate 50 years of Indian Physics Association. We thank all the viewers for their generous support to this activity. Many of our lectures have received a lot of viewing, and in fact, one of the first lectures has even the viewership has crossed thousands. So we really thank you and look forward to your support for remaining lectures. Please broadcast the information to your friends, colleagues, and all those who are interested in physics. Please subscribe to our channel on YouTube for the future updates. Today, we bring you the 14th lecture, and it's a very different topic than what we heard so far. This is taking us in a different dimension to the applications and a very exciting development for the development of ballistic resistant lightweight bulletproof jackets. And to give this talk today, we have Dr. Kinshuk Das Gupta with us. I request Dr. Kripamay Mehta from the Nuclear Physics Division BRC to introduce today's speaker. Dr. Kripa Mehta is a nuclear physicist, a great experimentalist, works in the nuclear reactions and nuclear fission, and has spent considerable time and effort and has developed a good detector development. So he is himself a good experimentalist, and now I invite him to introduce Dr. Kinshuk Das Gupta. Over to you, Kripa.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Vandana. Good afternoon to all. It is a pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Kinshuk Das Gupta, who has received Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize 2020 in Engineering Sciences for his work on carbon-based nanomaterials and composites, leading to the development of Bhabha Kavach, a lightweight import substitute ballistic resistant jacket for Indian Armed Force. Dr. Das Gupta joined BRC Mumbai as a scientific officer after completing his Bachelor in Engineering with Metallurgy and Material Science from Jadavpur University, Kolkata in 1999. He completed his PhD in Chemical Engineering from the Institute of Chemical Technology, Mumbai, and his PhD thesis received Ambuja Cement Best PhD Thesis Award. After that, he visited University of Cincinnati, USA as a Fulbright visiting scholar during 2018-19. He also received Young Metallurgist of the Year in 2007 by the Ministry of Steel, and he also received Young Engineer Award in 2012 and Scientific and Technical Excellence Award in 2017 by the Department of Atomic Energy. Dr. Das Gupta has been awarded Dr. N.J. Suchak Innovation Award 2019 by the Institute of Chemical Technology. And Dr. Das Gupta has filed two Indian patents, and he has authored three book chapters and has more than 90 publications in peer-reviewed journals. In addition to the Bhabha Kavach technology, he has transferred several other technologies to the industries, including large-scale synthesis of carbon nanotubes and rare earth magnetic alloy powders. Currently, he is serving as the head advanced carbon material section, GNAMD, Materials Group, BRC, and Associate Professor, Homi Bhabha National Institute, India. And apart from being a good researcher, as I already said, he is also a very good tabla player, and he actively participates in all cultural events organized by our Bengali Association in Anshaktinagar as a participant as well as organizer also. So with this, I will like to invite Dr. Kinshuk Das Gupta to tell us about his work. And I wonder whether there is a connection between the tabla and his Bhabha Kavach. So let us hear from him. Kinshuk.
Thank you, Dr. Kripamai, for your nice introduction. And also, I must thank Dr. Vandana for arranging this talk in this prestigious forum. I am really grateful to Indian Physics Association for giving me this opportunity to speak on their 50th anniversary program. So let me first share my screen. As all of you can see, I'll be talking on carbon nanomaterials and their applications. As the title suggests, I would like to emphasize on a particular element called carbon. And carbon, as we understand, it is a black color substance, but actually it is a wonderful material having wide range of structures and properties. And carbon can have crystalline as well as non-crystalline structures. Crystalline means the atoms are arranged in a periodic fashion over a long range. And among the crystalline structures, we get graphite, diamond. These are naturally occurring. Then we can have carbon nanotube, fullerene, graphene. And many of them are sp2 hybridized. Many of them are sp3 hybridized. We can have a mixture also. Among the non-crystalline structure, in which the atoms are not periodically arranged over a long range, but there can be short range order, we have amorphous carbon, soot, carbon black, glassy carbon. So you can see that we have a very wide variety of materials available with us. And their structures and properties can be tailored. That is the wonder of this material. Another nomenclature you can see in my title slide, that is called nanomaterials. So as you all know, nanomaterials mean a material having a dimension, at least one of its dimensions having size below 100 nanometer. And today I'll be talking about the nanostructured carbon materials and their applications in structural and functional materials. Now, if you can look at this slide, the basic building block, it is called a graphene. And this graphene is the layer of carbon atoms, a single layer of carbon atom, where these atoms are hexagonally arranged and they are sp2 hybridized. And if we stack them one above another, like ABAB fashion, we end up with a graphitic structure. If we want to roll them seamlessly, we can get carbon nanotube. Nanotube means it is a tubular structure having diameter in the nanometric range. It may be from 1 nanometer to till 100 nanometer. If there is a single tube, we call it single walled carbon nanotube or SWCNT. If there are concentric multiple number of tubes, we call them multi-walled carbon nanotube. Then, if we can give a curvature of this structure along with other geometric things like pentagons or heptagons, so we can make some kind football-like structure or cage-like structure. We call them fullerene. And again, if we can add oxygen atom along with the carbon atoms, that means if we oxidize them, we end up with graphene oxides. So all these nanostructured materials are having wonderful applications. And today, I'll be focusing on graphene and carbon nanotube. And as an engineer, my interest is how we can make these nanomaterials in large scale, and also we can apply for different applications. Why these two materials, that is carbon nanotube and graphene, they're popular? if we look at the properties of these carbon-based materials along with the steel, steel I have chosen as a reference because every day we use steel in our life. So if you see the strength and the Young modulus, they are almost same for nanotube, it is almost 10 times higher the strength, and you can see almost 60 times higher for graphene, single layer graphene. Similarly, Young modulus is also one order higher, and we can get very attractive thermal as well as electrical conductivity for these materials. And that is why these carbon nanomaterials, mostly CNT and graphene, they find applications for various applications, starting from composites, where they can be used as a pillar material. So we can use them in metal matrix composite, in ceramic matrix composite, in polymer matrix composite. We can use them for water treatment, gas adsorption, or energy storage, and utilizing their high specific surface area. We can functionalize the carbon nanotube or graphene surfaces with various ligands and use them for drug delivery. Then these materials can be used for sensors, as sensors in field emission, in catalysis. Today I'll be talking some of the applications which we are carrying out at VRC. Here in this slide, I'm showing few of the applications where we are focusing. The leftmost side, you can see that carbon nanotube can be incorporated in ceramic like boron carbide, and then also in polymer like ultra high molecular weight polyethylene. And we can come out with ceramic matrix carbon nanotube composite as well as polymer matrix carbon nanotube composites. And these two composites, they have been utilized in a product called Bhava Kavach, which is a lightweight ballistic resistance jacket. Then heteroatoms can be doped into the atomic lattice. So here we can dope boron or nitrogen. And by the doping, how their hydrogen storage properties and the kinetics of hydrogen storage alter, that also we are studying. And this carbon nanotube can be used for metal ion separation, where these like carbon nanotube polymer composite beads we have developed for rare earth extraction, and also for actinide separation, for water purification. Similarly, recently we have started work on graphene oxide and concrete composite. So like if we can mix graphene oxide with concrete, we have seen that its compressive strength improves very almost 40% to 50%, and the permeability decreases, so which is having really a good application. Another important structure is called carbon nanotube aerogel. It is a three-dimensional structure, self-assembled, where very long carbon nanotubes in the gas phase, they self-assemble and make aerogel. And from this, we can make sensors like biosensors, flexible capacitors, piezo sensors, chemical sensors. So these are the few applications where we are working using these materials. Now, today I'll be covering a synthesis part, something how these materials can be synthesized in large scale. And then how we are going to characterize them and few of the applications. And as I have told that we are interested in large scale production. So for like carbon nanotube, we have employed a process which is called fluidized bed chemical vapor deposition, where there should be some substrate material, which is fluidized in a furnace. Here in the left side photograph, you can see a fluidized wet furnace, which we have developed, designed and fabricated, which can produce carbon nanotube at a rate of 1 kilogram per day. And in the next slide, I'll show what fluidization means. And the product looks like tubular. That is why we call it carbon nanotube. This is the TEM image. And then rightmost side, the high resolution TEM image, where we can really count the number of walls, or we can see whether these are defectives or not. And these nanotubes are mostly in the range of 15 to 25 nanometer, having length in the micron size, 300 to 500 micron, and a purity almost up to 98.5%. So this is a typical fluidized wet furnace. I want to show you one video how what fluidization means. So we use some substrate material. In our case, it is carbon black, which is moved in this fashion, circular fashion, the video shows. When we pass a carrier gas called argon and some catalyst, which is ferrocene, which is kept in this preheater region. And during fluidization, this ferrocene is sent along with the carrier gas into the fluidization zone, which is at a high temperature. The ferrocene gets cracked and iron nanoparticle that they get deposited on the carbon black substance. And then hydrocarbon comes, we use acetylene. So hydrocarbon comes and it gets dissociated in hydrogen and carbon. This carbon molecule in the gas phase, when they come in contact with iron nanoparticle, they get dissolved and then carbon nanotube grows. So there are, in the fluidized bed, we have developed, this is the condition, but I want to show that we use carbon source as acetylene, support material as carbon black. There are reasons for using carbon black. This is a very cheap material and easily fluidizable. Then we use argon as a carrier gas, a synthesis temperature in the range of 700 to 1000 degrees centigrade. And we developed some reaction mechanism, what happened in fluidized bed. I just wanted to show some schematic. If you see, in fluidization, there is some two phases are there mostly. One is called emulsion phase. These black particles, which are carbon black and the gas, they are homogeneously mixed, which is called emulsion phase. And there is something called bubble phase. And this bubble phase is the excess gas which is coming. So initially the hydrocarbon, that is acetylene, that travels from the bubble phase to the emulsion phase. And when it comes to the emulsion phase, in the next stage, what happens? These are carbon black primary particles. So it has to diffuse through the carbon black and come in contact with the iron nanoparticle, which is sitting in the pores of these carbon blacks. So here you can see that the acetylene, it comes in contact with iron nanoparticle, it gets pyrolyzed, that means dissociated, and carbon molecules form. So these carbon molecules have solubility in the iron nanoparticle, and they get solubilized, they get saturated, then supersaturated, then after supersaturation, they come out as nanotubular structure, and the byproducts, they diffuse back. So there are 11 steps which we described, and corresponding to all steps, we developed some mathematical model. Why mathematical model is required? Because unless we develop the mathematical model and come out with an expression which describes the total process and find the rate controlling step, it is not possible for us to scale it up. Because once we know the rate controlling step, overall rate of reaction, then it is easy for us to scale up. So I'm not going into the details of this this part, but only one thing I want to emphasize, that very methodically we developed the mechanism, we developed the mathematical models, and then we could scale it up to this range, that where we can produce almost a kg of carbon nanotube per day without formation of impurities like other forms of carbon, like amorphous carbon. Then after we get the material, definitely we need to characterize. The first step is to do the electron microscopy, scanning electron microscopy, where we can see the fibrous kind of structure. But we don't know still whether it is a tube or it is a fiber. But from ACM, we can come to know the quality of the product, whether there are other impurities or not. And then we should go for TEM, that is transmission electron microscopy, where we can see how the product looks like, and we can calculate the outer diameter, inner diameter, etc. And depending on the temperature of synthesis, also you can study the variation. Next, we need to go for high resolution microscopy. So in high resolution microscopy, you can really count the number of walls. And here you can see it is 8 to 13. So these are all multiple carbon nanotubes. Another technique is called thermogravimetry, which is required to do in oxygen atmosphere or in presence of air to assess the impurity level. So by doing the thermogravimetry, we find out the amorphous carbon content and other impurities, and that is called that residual catalyst amount in the product. Now, as you all know, that microscopy, this electron microscopy, it takes some time because we need to prepare the sample. But a very quick technique and very effective technique is Raman spectroscopy for carbon-based materials. So here, some typical peaks like D-peak, G-peak, and 2D-peak, when we get them, and by looking at these peaks, we come to know whether these are multi-wall or carbon or single-wall carbon nanotube. Also, we can produce single wall carbon nanotube in fluidized bed, but the production rate is not as high as multi wall carbon nanotube, because for single wall carbon nanotube, we need to control the partial pressure of the hydrocarbon. We cannot pass very high hydrocarbon, because then there will be formation of multi wall carbon nanotube, and sometimes when the hydrocarbon pressure is very high, also soot formation may occur. So when we see under TEM, mostly this single wall carbon nanotube, they comes under bundle because of their very high specific surface area. But you can also see one single tube, the only one wall is there. But if we go to Raman, here the signature peak is there. That D peak, you don't see the D peak. But another peak called RBN, that is radial breathing mode. So that comes into picture. And from this RBN peak, we can also calculate the diameter of the single wall carbon nanotube. So far, I have talked about the fluidized bed method. There is another interesting technique, which is called floating catalyst chemical vapor deposition. That is also a versatile technique where by which we can produce multi-wall carbon nanotube, single-wall carbon nanotube, even graphene, and another interesting product that is called CNT aerogel, which I showed in my earlier slide, that it is a gas-based product where long nanotubes are self-assembled. So I'll be focusing on CNT aerogel, because floating catalyst CVD is specifically used to get the carbon nanotube aerogel. So this video, if you focus at this video, the furnace temperature is very high, and from the outside, a rod is pushed inside, that is collection rod, a steel rod, which rotates at a particular RPM. And you can see some from the vapor phase, the carbon, they are coming and condensing on the rod and they are growing. We can control here, these are all carbon nanotubes. We can control, they can be single wall, they can be multi-wall. Even in the single wall, they can be metallic, they can be semiconducting. Depending on the processing conditions, you can really control them. And we have filed a patent on that, that how we can control metallic and semiconducting carbon nanotube by this floating catalyst chemical vapor deposition. So in this way, we collect something, this CNT aerosol, and we have given a name CNT wool, because it is like wool kind of thing, or you can call it CNT cotton, from where you can make threads, so fibers. So this is very important for making fibers. As I told you that in floating catalyst chemical vapor deposition also, you can make the multi-walled carbon nanotube, and you can make single-walled carbon nanotube, and you can make this carbon aerosol. So carbon aerosol looks like this, the bottommost product you can see, this is CNT wool, and from which you can make the sensors. We have made different sensors using this material, very wonderful material. You can also produce graphene in floating catalyst chemical vapor deposition. So chemical vapor, floating catalyst chemical vapor deposition is a versatile process. Now coming to the applications. Now, so far I was talking about structures where these are pure carbon. Now, if I want to dope heteroatoms like nitrogen or boron into the structure. So this slide is showing if I dope nitrogen in the carbon lattice, so if I see the structures, microstructures in TM, we get tubes, but now these are bamboo shaped. So we get some compartments. So depending on the, so this nitrogen atom, they can get position at various lattice position, and you can have pyridinic, pyrolytic or pyrolytic duct structure. This was having some specific application in nuclear reactor, well, during the accidental release of hydrogen, whether those hydrogen can be captured. If we compare the hydrogen storage between the bare carbon nanotube and nitrogen doped carbon nanotube, you definitely see an increase in the hydrogen storage capacity of nitrogen doped carbon nanotube. And nitrogen doping, apart from getting the TM, which gives the structure, you can get the evidence from FTIR. So we get specific peaks corresponding to NC bonding. Now coming to boron doping, if you see boron, when we dope the boron, we don't get the compartment kind of structure or bamboo shaped structure. Rather, we get some defective kind of structure. It is a hollow tube with defects in the wall. But the advantage, if you see the boron doping, the hydrogen storage, the property improves very high. So here I have given a comparison with single wall, multi wall carbon nanotube. If you dope nitrogen, there is slightly improvement. And then when you dope boron, tremendous improvement in the hydrogen storage property. We also co-doped boron and nitrogen, and in this paper we have shown that Langmuir adsorption parameters, how they vary with only multiple carbon nanotube, and then the capacity, if you see the total absorption capacity, the maximum is with boron dope, then boron nitrogen co-dope, then nitrogen dope, and lowest is only without doping. We have utilized carbon nanotube for water purification as well. This is a macrostructure, tubular structure, where the carbon nanotubes, they have been grown on the radial radius of this and radial direction. So the thickness of the tube is basically carbon nanotubes, oriented carbon nanotubes in the radial direction. And we have studied the removal of arsenic, lead, chromium, etc., and other heavy metals from water, and adsorption of chloride from water as well. There are some concepts, means like you can make this geometry, and then so the water should flow from the hollow space, and it should come out of the surface, and then during that process, the heavy metals and other ions which you want to remove, they get trapped and the pure water comes out. Another important application in carbon nanotube is the separation of rare earths. This is one very important work where polymeric composite beads were prepared with carbon nanotube and PVA, polyvinyl alcohol. So carbon nanotube could modify the pore structure of the beads. So inside the bead, there is a hollow space where we can put DEFA, EFA, like this organic material, which is very specific for the rare earth extraction. And if we use these beads, by using these beads, we have seen that the uptake of rare earth improves hugely. So here, as a case study, say like yttrium, when no additives were there in the bead, the weight distribution ratio was just below 20, and it improves more than 120, that more than six times, when only 0.25 weight percent of CNT was added. So basically what happens, the CNT acts as a two ways. One thing, they modify the pore structure definitely. Another, CNT itself gets functionalized with the ligands, which is very specific to the rare earth. Like in this case, we wanted to specifically take out neodymium, Nd, from the magnetic scrap. So the scrap we dissolved. So in the magnetic scrap, there is Nd, iron, and boron. We want to take only the Nd. Those we could trap it. In the TEM, you can see the Nd metals, those are stuck on the surface of the carbon nanotube. Similarly, in actinide, they are like amidoamine is one group. So this was some theoretical study carried out in some other group of BRC in collaboration with us. So they showed that with amidoamine functionalization, you can get really this actinides can be separated very nicely. So in a bottle, the water, waste water, which contains uranium and americium, and if you add the amidoamine functionalized multiple carbon nanotube and shake them, so uranium and americium, they get loaded on this carbon functionalized carbon nanotube and settled, and you get the clear uranium and americium free water. So such kind of application we have. This is another interesting one. Like, you know that carbon nanotube is having a hollow core. So whether we can put some metal inside the core and check what is their property. So here we tried to put bimetallic, samarium and cobalt. As we know, samarium, cobalt, they make magnets, strong magnet, SMCO5, SM2CO17, these are strong hard magnets. Our interest was to check whether we can really put samarium and cobalt separately and try to see whether they can make those particular phase. So we could get SMCO5 phase and magnetic property we could find. So this can be used as a nanomagnet. This is having some applications. One thing is called hyperthermia. So in hypothermia, that magnetic particle filled carbon nanotubes are used. Recently, during the COVID time, lockdown time, we wanted to see whether carbon nanotube based filters, they can capture the virus particles or not. So as we are not experts in handling the actual COVID virus, we started with, in collaboration with our biology division, we started with something called bacteriophages. So bacteriophages are virus to the bacteria. So P1 phage we took, which was having a size similar in the range of our coronavirus, that is COVID. So we could show that this carbon nanotube based filters, where the pore size were below 100 nanometer, it could trap those P1 phages whose size range was 80 to 130 nanometer. It could trap them very efficiently, almost 99%, more than 99% was trapped. And even you can detect, second thing is whether we can detect them. So once they are trapped, we used Raman spectroscopy, and here I can show you that P1 with if you see the volume percent wise, very less volume percent. So also those could be, the signal could be obtained from Raman. We have a microfocal Raman spectra, that Raman instrument, so we could get the signal for that. So that is one application where we really can work on. Now, so far I have talked about nanotube. Now coming to another important material called graphene. So graphene is a two-dimensional material, we know, but really a two-dimensional single layer graphene, it is very difficult to handle. So some concept has come, three-dimensional graphene, 3D graphene. Means we have all the properties of 2D graphene, but they are grown in three dimension. We can produce them, one process called low pressure chemical vapor deposition. So this ACM and TM image, they're showing the flakes, which are, you can see, which are oriented in different directions. So these are three-dimensional graphene. We can also get another interesting structure, which is a composite structure, where we can have graphene, and on top of that, we can grow vertically aligned carbon nanotube. So this composite structure, they have very high specific surface area, and they have some typical applications. So here we could grow aligned carbon nanotube by plasma enhanced CVD, vertically grown on three-dimensional graphene. So bottom is three-dimensional graphene and top is carbon nanotube, aligned carbon nanotube. They have applications in sensing, which you can have, and also in case of, you can say, for the field emission kind of. This is another interesting structure. This is called graphene flower. So here, the graphene, vertically aligned graphene, like a very beautiful fashion. It is looking like rose. To me, it is looking like rose. But these are, these petals of the rose, all are graphene. And this structure is having very, very high specific surface area. And it is having application in supercapacitor kind of. So now I have shown how beautiful structures you can make depending on the your process parameters. By varying the process parameters, you can really develop very beautiful structures out of carbon. Now this is the last part of my talk, where I want to now share the application of carbon nanotube in Bhava Kavach, for which I have been conferred upon this Award. So the basic concept of bulletproof or ballistic resistant jacket, it has two main parts. One is called hard armor panel, another is called soft armor panel. The soft armor panel takes the body contour and it is flexible. This side is flexible. It can stop bullets of low caliber, like if a 9mm bullet is fired from the pistol or stun gun, soft armor panel can take care of that. But if you have higher caliber bullet, like we can have from INSAS, AK-47, so we require something called hard armor panel. It is hard. You can give some curvature, but once given, it doesn't have the flexibility. So this hard armor panel is put inside this pouch. And so a combination of soft armor panel and hard armor panel does the job. Now, talking about the ballistic performance or ballistic requirement, there are some levels, threat levels we talk. A threat from a 9mm bullet, 9mm, which is fired from a 9mm pistol or from stun gun. And next comes level 3 from AK-47 mild steel core bullet or a SLR. And then level 3 plus, where hard steel core bullets are used and with an INSAS rifle. So for level 3A, only flexible polymers, that is the soft armor panel is sufficient. And level 3, we require hard armor panel along with soft armor panel, but here only we compress the polymers or polymer carbon nanotube. But in polymer can do the work, but in level 3 plus, we require a ceramic or a metal along with polymer backing to stop the bullet. So what was the objective for development of Bhava Kavach? Kavach was, the jacket was already existing, but they were heavy. So we wanted to develop a lightweight jacket. It should have a multi-hit capability. That means after one bullet, you should not be vulnerable for death. Means your jacket should give you sufficient protection. So you should have at least 6 to 8 bullets with the jacket. And third is reducing the blunt trauma or backface signature. This is very important term. What is blunt trauma? Means even if the bullet is stopped, the energy of the bullet, which is dissipated, and it can cause a protrusion backside. And the protrusion, if it is very large, it can damage your internal organs, vital organs. And in this way, the death can happen. Even the bullet is stopped, still you can become dead if your blunt trauma or backface signature is high. So how backface signature is measured? So like this is a plasticine material which resembles our body muscle. So on top of the plasticine, this is having a typical properties. So on top of that, the armor panel is fixed and then bullet is hit. And whatever impression we get in the plasticine, that is measured and that is called the backface signature. So we should have maximum value for that. So we need to develop a material which causes low backface signature. So in the hard armor panel, as I already told, what is the philosophy? Means it should stop the bullet in two ways. One, we require a very hard face where we use hot pressed boron carbide and recently hot pressed boron carbide and carbon nanotube. So by its hardness, it defeats the bullet. Defeats means it breaks the bullet In the next slide, I'll show the mechanism. So here, behind the ceramic, you place the layered structure of polymer and carbon nanotube. So if you see the mechanism, how it comes, when a bullet comes, and initially it is when it's stuck, so its outer jacket, it gets deformed, and the ceramic starts being a brittle material. They make some, there is a damaged region, and conic, this fracture, they get fractured. And next, the jacket, that outer jacket, they don't come inside, but the core, it penetrates. So it passes through this ceramic. The ceramic gets fractured, and everything, these fragmented bullets as well as the broken ceramics, they need to be contained in this backing material. These are the layered structures. So few of the layers, they get ruptured, and finally, their content. So this is the mechanism by which, so we need to make this ceramic very hard, as well as if we can impart some toughness into the ceramic, what will happen, it will absorb more energy from the bullet. And in the backing material, we need to increase the stiffness. So how we have toughened the ceramic, we have used carbon nanotube, graphene nanoparticle, as well as we have seen that carbon fiber. We processed all these three materials along with boron carbide by hot pressing technique, and we made some tiles. And we checked first, say in XRD, whether there are some oxide phases that are still remaining, because boron carbide starts from boron oxide. So that should not be there. Then go for the Raman to check whether we have boron carbide and signature of that filler material. Okay, if this is having, then we go for, say, we varied different percentage of carbon nanotube, and how we should that with initial increase, say from initially you say get a very porous, some kind of porous structure of ceramic, but if you add on carbon nanotube at 2% volume, 5% volume, you get very dense structure. But again, when it is high, like 10% volume, you get agglomerate. Similar things happen with if we get graphene nanoparticle and as well as carbon fiber. But here now I am showing the comparison of these three and what we choose finally. So I told three properties are important. Hardness, because by the hardness it needs to beat the bullet. Its hardness should be higher than the bullet's hardness. Flexural strength, if the flexural strength is good, then you require very small thickness of that. So you can reduce the thickness of the tiles. In that way, the weight of the jacket, if you have a good flexural strength, and similarly fracture toughness as well. So if you see, with 5% volume CNT, all the properties, optimum we are getting. And as we had a capability of making carbon nanotube in large scale, we went for that boron carbide and carbon nanotube composite. And this is so many tiles we made, and from that we could make the boron carbide hexagonal pieces, and those are used in Bhava coverage. And how carbon nanotube improves the backing material performance, here I could show you one DS image where we showed that carbon nanotube, when treated with ultra high molecular polyethylene, they make some bond which is very strong. And in this way, and if you can see this microstructure as well, where you can see the interlayer structure, there is a bridging between this interlayer structure by carbon nanotube. So what happened? We improved the properties of the ceramic as well as the polymer. And then we went for this testing. It is a rigorous testing, something called conditioning, where these hard armor panels, they undergo thermal cycling starting from minus 65 to plus 40 degrees centigrade, 45 degrees centigrade. even in one case 90 degrees centigrade also for small time it goes. And the sap, that is soft armor panel, it undergoes tumbling. Tumbling means in a tumbler, it is rotated at a particular RPM for 10 days under water. So the sap undergoes tumbling, the HAP undergoes conditioning. So total process is 10 days. And on the 11th day, there will be firing. So it is not on the as prepared jacket. The jackets are conditioned, they are tumbled, they are subjected to drop test, and after that it is fired, and jacket should withstand the bullets. So I am just showing some example that normal what jacket our forces used to have, they showed this much dent on the plasticine. This is back face signature, which is around more than 40 to 44 millimeter, where Bhava Kavach, you can hardly see the dent, which is below 10 millimeter. And this is the bullet struck, SLR AK-47 bullet stuck on the Bhava Kavach. If you see under X-ray radiography, you can check the fragments of the bullets, and these are entrapped. Then we developed various design of Bhava Kavach, like regular design for that's with 180 degree protection. That means front and backside protection of ceramic protection is there. This was meant for the CISF. Then for Northern Command in Jammu Kashmir, we have 360 degree. Means inside also we have ceramic. That was their requirement. Then something called standalone design. Those are for CRPF. And for various elite forces, we produced Bhava Kavach. And this year in February, Dr. BRC handed over Bhava Kavach to the DG of CISF. And we transfer the technologies to almost 5 companies, big companies. And Bhava Kavach already, more than 1,000 Bhava Kavach orders are there. And also Bhava Kavach got wide media coverage. So that was a good application of carbon nanomaterials for the societal, you can say, or defense purpose. And with this, I would like to conclude. But before conclusion, I must acknowledge the contributions of my team members. I have a wonderful team, and they work tirelessly, and really for their effort only this much has happened. And I must thank my mentors and collaborators at BRC as well as other institute. And thank you all for your kind attention. Thank you.
Should I take over or?
Yes, Kripa, please go ahead.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Dr. Kingsukh Das Gupta, for giving us explaining in details the characterization of carbon nanotubes and their wide variety of applications you are trying to, or you have developed already. And now we can, this talk is open for comments and discussion. So we'll take the YouTube questions first. There are a few questions on YouTube. One is from Dr. Basav Raj Kagil. His question is, can you filter out radioactive nuclei from reactor water and hence prevent health hazards?
Can you repeat the question?
The question is that, can you filter out radioactive nuclei from reactor waters and hence prevent health hazards?
Yeah, definitely. I have shown one slide that you can take out radionuclides. See here, the carbon nanomaterials, they can be functionalized with the ligands, which are very target specific ligands. They can attack particular radionuclide, and you can adsorb them and take out.
Okay. And again, it is his question only. So what is the minimum size of the particles that CNT can filter?
The nanometer size, see, basically,
okay,
if you see it depends on the size of the CNT, because when there should be inter nanotube space, mostly where the materials are trapped, and this is in the nanometer dimension. So definitely nanometric dimension, if it is not below 2 to 3 nanometer, CNT can easily filter it out.
Okay. So his last question is that, is there a limit to the size dimension of graphene sheets one can produce industrially?
Graphene sheets means, if you are calling two-dimensional graphene, I think that the limitation is based on the your synthesis dimension of your furnace or something.
Okay.
Otherwise, as such, theoretically, there is no limitation. So if you have a very big furnace, you can make big two-dimensional graphene. I have worked personally on three-dimensional graphene, and you can make a A3 size, A3 paper size three-dimensional graphene. It is doable. Even bigger than that is possible if you have that much size of furnace where you want to finally synthesize the graphene.
And there is another question from Mr. Prabhat Kumar. What is the composition of CNT, composite materials, in your study?
CNT means carbon nanotube. And I think he wanted to refer to the composite. That means CNT along with that, what is there?
Yeah.
So as I told, in case of ceramic, it is boron carbide. It was for a particular application, Bhava Kavach. And for polymer, it was ultra high molecular polyethylene. Otherwise, the carbon nanotube can be used as a filler material in any other matrix, like metal matrix, like in aluminium people use. In other polymers, you can make like PVA and all these things possible.
So that's all from YouTube. Now we can maybe go for if there is any question in Zoom.
Yeah, so I have a kind of general question. Firstly, very, very nice talk. And I think there are also on the YouTube, there are a lot of compliments about the talk. So the looking at this aspect which you brought out, starting from graphene and carbon nanotube to take it to this kind of application, do you, given the scope now for this, it has for applications in many materials, do you really, do you envisage that in about another decade or so, the like we have plastic in abundance, many, many things which we come across, or many materials where certain even toughness and things are required, will these carbon nanotube materials will replace and these common materials in life which I used?
Actually, it has the potential, definitely. Two things we need to keep in mind. First of all, the cost should be such that common people should be able to use. So we need to develop a process. See, if you today look at the internet, the carbon nanotube cost 1 lakh rupees per kg. That is a multi-walled. And single wall is much more. Few lakhs maybe per gram. That is the international price. But at BRC, what the methodology we developed, we calculated carbon nanotube, you can make less than 10,000 rupees a kg at lab, so that if this can go to industry, it's much cheaper. So see the difference, and we need, that is why our, as engineer, our job should be whether we can make this affordable. If we can make this affordable, this material is having tremendous properties, then it replaces some other material. But unless the cost can be, see, ultimately every use depends on the cost.
Sure.
Day-to-day use.
Yeah, but...
So we need to make it at large scale at affordable price. That is the main. And actually our objective is that all these nanomaterials, we are exotic. We should develop some methodology by which we can make in large scale, keeping the properties intact, but at a lower cost.
Okay, I have one more question, since there is time I'll ask, because you know we are also expecting that the viewership is young students and who will be more motivated by this talk. So I think it would be nice if you say a few words about how you got motivated in working into this area and how you thought of getting from the carbon nanotube material to the Bhava Kavach.
One thing is that my background is metallurgist. So generally metallurgists work in metals, but somehow when I was into the research, I was given a task of making peculiar thing one that is called amorphous carbon, making amorphous carbon for some structural application. If you go to a physicist or a chemist, they will tell you amorphous carbon cannot be made in large structural purpose. It is because the structure is such that it is not possible. But they're from the journey started. So I started thinking, why not? Where is the problem? So you can really, we made then a very long tube out of amorphous carbon by modifying our thinking process that, okay, this is the obstruction. So how we can overcome that? So in that way, and then that time carbon nanotube was coming into picture and we were, that again, the cost was very high, very exotic material cost is very high. So our thinking was how we can really make the cost low. So we need to, and also can make it at a larger scale. And I am lucky to have few people as my mentors, like one Professor Joshi, with whom I did my PhD, then Dr. Banerjee, then Dr. Madan Gopal Krishnan, Dr. G.K. These people, they motivate you to think in these directions. So when you get a good mentor and you get support, you'd start thinking and then something good come out of that.
Thank you. I think this will be a useful advice for many youngsters. I'm sure they'll be very inspired by your talk. Thanks.
Yeah. Okay.
Any other question? Maybe I just from Vandana's question, I iterate my mind. But this for wide applications, whether it is environment friendly, it means like a biodegradable and all.
See, carbon is the environment, because if you see the structure, basic organic structure, carbon is one of the element always.
Yeah.
The problem is the nanos. What happens, nanomaterials, they have some hazards when we inhale. And it can go into our lungs and it can block. So we need to take precaution while handling fine materials. But when we make it into product, then it is not any, it doesn't have toxicity in that way. But it can be hazardous if fine particles, that is in any fine particles, if we inhale, we have problem. So we need to take precaution so that we don't inhale them. But when we make it product, I don't think there is any problem after making it into the product.
Thank you. So, no other question? I think YouTube also, mostly people are appreciating. No other question? So, now I, Vandana, we should now close the session or
I'll just give a small vote of thanks. I have to thank you also for conducting the lecture. So thank you, Dr. Kinshuk Das Gupta and Dr. Kripa Mehta. Dr. Kripa Mehta for conducting the lecture, and Dr. Kinshuk Das Gupta, as you all heard, for a very, very inspiring and exciting talk. We wish you all, all of us wish you very, very best, Dr. Kinshuk, for your future endeavors. And I'm sure you will come up with something really more path breaking than this and it is there. So we really appreciate your talk. And I'm sure, as I said earlier also, it will be inspiring to many youngsters to think out of box and come up with some things which have really wide applications. And it's good to bring out the role of all the various different aspects of science which play the role. So wish you all more success in future. And thank you very much for this talk. Thank you all for the listening to this talk, joining us. So please do join us next Saturday. Next Saturday, we have a talk by Professor Amlan Paul, who is director of UGC DAE Consortium, Indore. So we will please.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Vandana.
Thank you. Stay safe, all of you. Bye-bye.